Understand that we are not simply missionaries, but politicians as well. And know that our eventual goal is to lead all non-Russian peoples of Russia to a common Russian identity. This proclamation is made by a fictionalized Nikolai Ilminsky, a prominent Orthodox missionary figure in the late 19th century, whose work was mostly in the Volga region, also a little bit in Central Asia. This statement reflects in many ways the complicated nature of memory, particularly the memory of the political and cultural encounter between the Russian Empire and its subject minorities in Narodtsy, and in this period in the late 19th century. So in contemporary Tatar literature and Tatar scholarship, Ilminsky's project has become a site for continued investigation, both of the past and of the present. In many ways, this period of Ilminsky's mission in the late 19th century has become, to these Tatar writers and thinkers, a crucial moment in the making of Tatar nationality, of the Tatar nation, and as such has become a metaphor to discuss Tatar relations, not only in the past, but also in the present day Russian Federation. So my paper today will focus on two recent examples of Tatar cultural production, although there are many others, a few of which I could say something about in the question and answer section. The first is a film filmed by Ramil Tufatulin, and the second is a short story by Tufan Minulin, first published in a Tatar journal and later in a national literary journal in the Russian Federation. In looking at these sources and similar sources, I'm interested in how the imperial past, and especially this missionary context, is being remembered today, and what potential consequences these rememberings have for conceptions of Tatar identity in the 21st century. So just to begin with a little bit of historical context, I won't go into the historical context of Ilminsky's missionary mission in particular. Instead, I'll start with kind of the Tatar sovereignty movement in the beginning under Gorbachev with Perestroika and Glasnost, and then especially in the 1990s and continuing today. With the collapse of the USSR, and even a little bit before that under Gorbachev, there was a quest in Russia's ethnic minority regions to assert newfound political and cultural sovereignty, just as, of course, the Union Republics had actually asserted actual independence from Russia or from the Soviet Union. These autonomous regions within the Russian Federation were also attempting to do this, albeit on a smaller scale. So in Tatarstan, this eventually leads to the creation of a bilateral agreement in 1994. This model of political association is known as the Tatarstan model, mostly to differentiate it from the Chechenian model, which was bringing back into the Russian Federation through force. Tatarstan was, in many ways, too strong, in my opinion, to have done that. Russia was much more willing to compromise, and also Tatars were also willing to compromise. They didn't want what happened in Chechnya to happen in Tatarstan. As Helen Faller argues in her study of the sovereignty movement, in the 1990s, sovereignty was encapsulated in a political movement. And this political sovereignty was based mostly upon a quest for linguistic reform, which included the adoption of the Latin alphabet in particular. And this political sovereignty was meant to kind of assert or kind of reinvigorate Tatarstan's kind of voluntary association into the Russian Federation, which is, of course, what the 1994 treaty purported to do. But political sovereignty was defeated in many ways under Putin because of verticalization of power. And Tatars, since that period, have feared that the bilateral agreement will be terminated and that Tatarstan will be transformed into another gubernia. Actually, there are Helen Faller talks about, that Tatars today still fear that Russian tanks will just pour over the border and they will no longer, they will be turned into, you know, a regular Russian state as opposed to this autonomous republic. They were especially fearful of this recently with Ukraine, with Crimea. They saw that this may be related. In the Putin period and in these sources that I'm looking at specifically, Tatar nationality and nationhood become viewed through, instead of this kind of linguistic political sovereignty, instead they become connected to religion, shared religious experience, and especially with my sources, the shared religious experience of this missionary effort in the late imperial period. This religious focus is also linked to kind of a civilizational type approach to ethnic kind of identity, in the sense that mixed marriages, which were prevalent in the Soviet period, have now been kind of rejected by Tatar nationalists. This idea of mixed marriages being not so great is brought up in the film Zuleha, and is also brought up, although more vaguely, in the short story I will talk about. So to begin with Zuleha, this film was released in 2004 in Tatarstan. It is in Tatar, although I use the version with Russian subtitles because my Tatar is not that great yet. It's available freely over the internet for us. I'm not sure if it is for Russians also, but I suppose everything's on Kontaktia. It was actually shown to me by my Tatar professor when I was in Kazan 2 years ago. So Tatars know this film. It was released kind of in Tatarstan. It's based on a Gaya's Iskaki play that was first performed in 1917. The play is mostly about a Tatar apostate who was converted to Christianity but eventually kind of moves back to Islam and then is punished for this. Agnes Kefeli has described the original play as a refashioning of traditional Islamic tale and as an appeal for national and religious unity among ethnic Tatars. And so the film is actually a very faithful recreation of the play. It is, for the most part, exactly the same. It emphasizes unique Tatar cultural and religious heritage, and that this heritage linked with trauma, the trauma of the missionary event. It also highlights, in many ways, the shared suffering of both Russians and Tatars because of this project, and especially the suffering of mixed children. The only significant departure is the inclusion of Nikolai Elminsky and his kind of colleague, Yefimi Malov, who is also involved in this missionary project. They're not in the play, but they are purposely put into this film. So the focus of the story is Zuleha, a baptized Tatar apostate who has returned to Islam. She is in many ways a metaphor for the Tatar community. She's the victim of an oppressive Russian state, and shows enormous resilience in her devotion to her family, to her culture, and to her religion. When she's accused of apostasy, by a local priest, she's sent to a monastery, and from there she's forced to marry a local Russian and bear him a mixed child. So the film is kind of bookended by these kind of narrative scenes where there's kind of like these visions of like conquest. It almost looks like it's taken from like the Ivan Grozny film, the Soviet era film, with just text written over it. So the narrator's speaking in Tatar, but there are these Russian subtitles. And from what I could tell, the narrator's not saying anything different in Tatar. The Tatar is what the Russian says, which isn't always the case with what Tatars say and how it's translated. But in this kind of opening introduction, this narration, the narrator actually implores us to see Zuleha as this metaphor for popular resistance to a colonial oppressor, and also kind of points out the inability of the oppressor to actually wipe out the Tatar culture. And primarily this Tatar culture is embodied in Islam, according to the narration. So the actual opening scene is this point of divergence. There's a dialogue between Ilminsky and Malov, And so Malov, whose kind of missionary efforts are focused on argument, kind of defeating Islam through rational kind of debate, says Ilminsky's system is failing. And he says, you know, the apostasy is proof that Ilminsky's system doesn't work. All these people are converting back to Islam. But Ilminsky says, no, actually, my system works. It's based on translation education. And he says, no, because we formed these national cadres, and that even Krashans, these baptized Tatars, have now begun to consider themselves a distinct and separate nation apart from Tatars. He says, you know, you cannot always destroy these opponents through force, but you can destroy them through learning. Because what Ilminsky's system does, according to this film, is kind of sidestep the problem that this kind of shared religious devotion has. Russia, kind of the Russian Orthodox missionary project, superimposes national and ethnic differences among Russia's Turkic Muslim population and helps to sap this kind of shared devotion from the Islamic identity. Or at least this is, you know, what the film is presenting it as. This scene helps to contextualize the rest of the film. It kind of, you know, this is what the story of Zuleha is about. It's about these artificial divisions created by the Russian state. Ilminsky's presence also arguably helps to historicize this tale. I mean, it's kind of, you know, it's a parable, but because he's there, this is actual real history now, arguably. This also draws further attention, as I'll mention a couple times, to the Krashans, who are these baptized Tatars who are Orthodox Christian, but are still Turkic. And so neither Tatars nor Russians know exactly who these people should be. And so we'll speak to them again. Or actually, no, I have a quick little quote from them. There's actually a scene later in the movie, and it's in a Krashan village, and there are both Russians and Krashans here. A Russian is kind of, they're talking, and the Russian is very annoyed by the Krashan. And he's annoyed because the Krashan can't speak Russian correctly. His Russian's very accented, it's not good. And he says, how can you even be Orthodox without speaking Russian correctly? How can you hope to be Orthodox if you're not also Russian? So there's this connection between faith and nationality, and as we'll see in Manulin's short story, the theme is emerging both here and there that Tatars should be Muslim and Russia should be Orthodox. And when the dichotomy is challenged because of this imperial project, because of this missionary project, there are problems. So just to kind of point out a couple of scenes that I think are particularly important, there's kind of this narrative of, you know, Tatars should be Muslim, Russians should be Orthodox, but there's also the narrative of kind of religious reconciliation. So there's actually a scene where the priest is bringing a cross to erect on top of a mosque to convert it into a church, and as he's coming to this village, he's stopped by the Muslim elder who urges the priest, you know, don't destroy the mosque by putting a cross on it. Both our peoples worship the same God. We both sail on the same boat in the society. We're linked. In another scene, after this cross is put on the church, on the mosque, a Tatar who, he almost seems drunk, but I mean, he's Tatar, so I imagine that he's not. He burns down the church, this mosque that has now been converted into a church. And then, just weeping, he kind of walks over to the priest and holds him. So there's this shared kind of trauma in this religious mission that has kind of destroyed both peoples. The religions seem at odds in this imperial context, but the elder believes that these antagonisms are manufactured, that they shouldn't exist. These people they worship the same God. They live in the same society. In the conclusion of the film, and I have a couple other scenes also, but in the conclusion of the film, the narrator, let's just move on to story. I can talk more about this in the question and answer. In the story, It's the story by Tufan Minulin, who was actually a deputy in the Tatar parliament. He was a permanent member. And he kind of, in this play, which is about an argument between Malov and a Tatar convert, Akhmerov, he kind of is making this this narrative about this kind of, this imperial position and the kind of way in which this mission destroys ethnic Tatars. So just kind of to, let's see if I can find some good specific ones. There's this argument between Akhmerov and Malov, and of course Malov is trying to convert Akhmerov through this kind of, through argument, and Malov is, you know, trying to gain things from, or Akhmerov is trying to gain things from Malov in this conversion. So he says, oh, if you give me vodka, like, then I'll start saying Orthodox prayers. But he's kind of combining this with also Muslim prayers. And so it's not clear what identity he wants to be. And eventually he kind of loudly declares, I'm no longer Sahib Garay, you know, his Tatar name. I'm Peter. And he lays the blame of kind of this failed conversion on Malov. He says, you know, you failed at doing this. And you know, you've damned me because I no longer have the, I'm no longer loyal to this religion of my ancestors. He eventually announces that Islam and Christianity are both totally lies. Only the devil can be trusted. And he kind of breaks down and runs into the streets where he's kind of pelted by trash by local Tatars because he's gotten rid of his own faith. And he only now has this kind of, this bastardized faith that he doesn't belong to either people. That, you know, Malov kicks him out, but the Tatars don't want him either. So obviously in the question and answer, I'm gonna have to like do a lot. But so to kind of summarize what I was trying to do, in the way in which Tatars kind of return to the imperial period in this myth making is a way to use the past in order to make arguments about Russia's multicultural present. The historical processes that led to these divisions between these peoples are moralized and are placed into conversation with present events. Today, Tatar literary and cultural intelligentsia seeks to maintain Tatarstan's precarious cultural autonomy in the face of an increasingly nationalist Russian Federation. Mingikhanov, the president of Tatarstan, much like Kadyrov in Chechnya, maintains political authority because he is loyal to Putin, he's pro-Putin, but he's also allowed a lot of leeway in cultural affairs within Tatarstan. And you know, recently this has kind of developed into Russian professors have been fired from KFU. There's been the publication of pro-Tatar anti-Russian textbooks. This has led to some backlash, but also there is this continued cultural sovereignty here in Tatarstan, like other ethnic regions. And I would argue that the works of Tukhwatulin, Minulin, and others are part of this cultural production that asserts this cultural autonomy of Tatars. But I think that, and I'll explain this more, you know, if you have questions, but I don't think the nationalism of these Tatar nationalists has to necessarily be at odds with Russian nationalism. Because of this reconciliation that's placed in both stories, there's an idea that as long as Tatars are Muslim and Orthodox, or Russians are Orthodox, there doesn't need to be a conflict between them. They can kind of be as nationalist and separate as they want. It can still work together. Moreover, the nationalists are pretty small in number, although it seems likely that a lot of Tatars kind of at the kitchen table share these ideas. They don't articulate them on their own. There's also new Eurasianist ideologies at play in Russia, and these help to link the various peoples of the Russian Federation together into a larger cultural unit. It's possible for Tatars who remain Muslim to still be a part of Russia, a greater country that is not only Russian, but is all these peoples put together. And so, I mean, I didn't have a chance to elaborate on this too much, but the threat really for these people is the people who don't fit in, the people who aren't Tatar and Muslim, the people who are Tatar and Orthodox. And so when, you know, when these boundaries, these very kind of in my opinion, kind of inherited from the Soviet period, the kind of immutable national and ethnic differences that were created in the Soviet period. These have been inherited by the post-Soviet states, and now, you know, it's these people who transgress them which are the problem for these thinkers. So, thanks.
Hey, next up we have Bradley Gorski. Bradley is a graduate student at Columbia University in Slavic Languages and Literatures, and his dissertation project on strategies of moral positioning in post-Soviet Russian culture includes chapters on disgust, violence, gender, and geography. His paper today is titled Aleksei Ivanov's Buried Treasure, Pugachev's Rebellion, and the Riches of Ural Geography.
Thank you, Rachel, and thanks to everybody for waking up early. I'm going to talk about Aleksei Ivanov's novel Zolota Bunta, which is an unlikely bestseller. Weighing in at 700 pages and detailing the culture of river navigation in the 18th century Urals, the book seems out of place in contemporary Russian literature. But it has sold over 100,000 copies since its release, outpacing several more familiar authors like Pelevin and Ulitskaya, and making Ivanov into the most improbable literary phenomenon of the last decade. This paper attempts to understand that phenomenon, first by analyzing how Zolota Bunta works on its readers. I will argue that the novel's success can be accounted for not despite, but in part because of its length and difficulty. I will concentrate here on the difficulty of its language, which seems to inspire a sense of wonder or enchantment in its readership. Second, I will look at Ivanov's various ancillary projects, especially the photo album Uvidit Ruski Bunt, to see a Russian revolution, as they attempt to redirect aesthetic enthusiasm towards the formation of contemporary regional identity. I would add here a topical note. In the wake of the dissolution of the Ministry of Regional Development last fall, tasks like the, quote, development and realization of state ethnic policy and the, quote, realization of ethno-cultural needs of the citizenry have fallen to none other than the Ministry of Culture, making the aesthetic management of local identity an issue that goes beyond Ivanov's Urals project. Upon first encountering Zolota Bunta, readers, and especially critics, have been struck by the novel's language. Lev Danilkin, writing in Afisha, says that trudging through even the very first paragraph, quote, requires stubbornness and effort. All the, quote, archaisms, dialects, and scrupulous reconstructions of obsolete 18th century technologies, quote, test one's patience, действует на нервы. Dmitry Bykov's nerves likewise felt the strain. His review in Novy Mir cites an impossible passage from the text, which I'll put up here, but I won't attempt to read out loud, and then complains that this type of language is enough to drive you crazy, quote, взбесишься тут. Ivanov could have, Bykov goes on, written the novel in clear Russian, as he has done in other works, like Geograph Globus Prepil. But instead, he veils Zolota Bunta in an impenetrable, reconstructed 18th century Ural dialect that includes not only technical terms from industries long since disappeared, but also vocabulary borrowed from the surrounding Finno-Ugric cultures. Most professional reviewers approach Ivanov's difficult language this way, as a barrier to, distraction from, or at best a patina superimposed on the exciting adventure plot that readers are really after. Indeed, the plot, even buried as it is under layers of difficult language, offers no shortage of excitement. Set 4 years after Pugachev's rebellion, the novel follows Astasha Perekhod as he tries to uncover the details of his father's death and reclaim his rightful place as a captain of his own barge. Rumors circulate that Astasha's father, himself the region's best river captain, intentionally crashed his vessel and faked his own death in order to sneak off with Pugachev's gold. To clear his name, Astasha must find the gold himself and find the truth. His quest leads to several fights to the death, lots of sex, plenty of pagan mysticism, and one vast conspiracy that trades in souls, lives, and gold. The plot, which Ivanov has admitted owes something to Hollywood thrillers, might seem to explain the book's success, but reader discussion boards show a different reaction. There, the language itself emerges as a source of enjoyment, And here I'll put quotes up in Russian, but read them in my translations. Quote, "The book's language, without question, deserves respect. I haven't seen beauty like this in a long time," writes one reader. "First and foremost, I got pleasure precisely from the process of reading. The plot was secondary." Another reader adds, "The language and the images and the pagan culture, it all creates a world that not only reads in one breath, but that lives on in the memory." A third response seems to bring together professional reviewers' reactions with those of the title. Quote, "The novel seriously swallowed me up. Even though it's written in a pretty unfamiliar archaic language, you wouldn't say it's easygoing, but reading it was unbelievably entertaining." This reader had to apply effort to get into Ivanov's difficult text, but the result is not, as one might expect, an experience made more meaningful for being difficult, but an unbelievably entertaining read in its own right. The difficult language seems to play a central role in these readers' intense experience of the text. Another reader enthusiastically admits to not understanding much of the book. Quote, a good half of the Gold of the Rebellion is written in local dialects without any explanation or notes. It's left to the readers to guess the meaning of several words. But, this reader continues, this, I believe, is the value of the Gold of the Rebellion. Ivanov managed a unique immersion in the text and in the depicted era. So much passion goes into the description of navigation along the springtime Chusovaya, each turn, each warrior cliff, that it seems as if you yourself are sitting in a barge that's carrying several tons of iron. Paradoxically, the very impenetrability of Ivanov's language makes for a reading experience that is intensely entertaining, immersive, and even realistic. Let's see. Language so opaque has often has a performative aspect. It is not so much describe as it does something. It acts upon its audience. One of the readers says that the book casts a spell, charuyet. And that is not far from what I mean to suggest. Like the words of an incantation, the impenetrable vocabulary depends for its magic on a meaning just beyond the reader's grasp. In interviews, Ivanov has insisted that the authenticity of Zolotabunta's language, claiming to have reconstructed it from dictionaries, from folk knowledge, and quote, as God provided, kakush bogdal. This suggestion of authentic meaning just beyond our understanding frustrates clear interpretation, but invites further investigation. The near discernibility of meaning compels concentration while keeping understanding just out of reach. In this linguistic environment, each new episode of the exciting adventure plot provides a moment of transparency, as though opening a window onto the inaccessible world behind the language. The book alternates every few pages between these clear, plot-driven sections and the archaic technical descriptions of the natural environment and river navigations. Strange language combines with a quick plot to alternately mask and reveal a world foreign to the reader's own experience and enchanting enough to make 700 pages fly by in a single breath. The effect, it seems to me, has much in common with Jane Bennett's notion of enchantment. Enchantment, according to Bennett, produces a peculiar combination of affects that aligns well with the reader's experiences in Zolotabunta. She mentions intense concentration, a quote, suspension of chronological time, heightened sensory perception, and exhilaration. To be enchanted, Bennett writes, is, quote, to be simply transfixed in wonder and transported by sense, to be both caught up and carried away. This odd combination of somatic effects, as she calls it, is interesting for Bennett and for my purposes here for two reasons. First, because it works against a modernist narrative, most prominently articulated by Max Weber, in which we live in a world disenchanted by rationalization and intellectualization. Zolotabunta attempts to revive the enchantment for its readers, reactivating a pre-modern affective experience through a contemporary aesthetic object. And second, because, as Bennett argues, enchantment might be able to provide the, quote, motivational energy needed to move selves to the actual practice of ethical behaviors in the real world. I will return to how Zolota Bunta's enchanting effect moves its readers to certain behaviors, but first I want to examine the central locus of enchantment within the novel's fictional world, the natural environment, which emerges as the moral foundation most capable of structuring social relations in a post-traumatic world. We enter Zolota Bunta 4 years after Pugachev's rebellion, as the shadow of the uprising continues to dominate a murky moral landscape. The region, deprived of outside forces and abandoned by the grand events of geopolitical history, is left to grapple with itself, to forge a new moral equilibrium among the various internal forces at conflict. And here it is not difficult to see analogs with post-Soviet present. Doubly bereaved by the death of his father and the destruction of the old order, the protagonist, Astasha Perekhod, finds himself ethically adrift, unable to fully subscribe to any of the belief systems offered by the various factions around him. The Nikonianci, the heretical Istiazhtsi, the shamanistic Mansi, which are here called Vaguli. He finds no foundation more reliable than his self-centered quest to find the gold and clear his father's name. Meanwhile, the surrounding environment seems to come alive, taking actions that change the course of events at crucial points in the novel. At one such moment, Nastasha has been taken prisoner in an underground hermitage when the cavern suddenly collapses, killing his incarcerators and freeing Nastasha from their grasp. Later, Nastasha escapes captivity once again when a blizzard produces a supernatural hallucinogenic effect that swallows up his captors and lets him go free. The environment is surprisingly agentive, to the point where Astasha begins to appeal to it as a sort of moral authority. He ends an argument at one point by shouting, "The river will be the judge of who's right and who lies." And later he tells off an evil leader by saying, quote, "Your power stands on nothing because you have no power over the Chusovaya River." Astasha seems to trust in the natural world's fairness, even if he doesn't fully understand its mechanisms. When captaining a barge, Astasha can read the eddies and whirls of the Chusovaya only by a combination of intense concentration and intuition. And even so, he mutters incantations and prayers for intercession. The environment in Zolota Bunta is an enchanted presence in the novel, active, imminent, but beyond human understanding. It rises above the human factions and squabbles and offers a different kind of moral code, one that is not self-serving, but transcendent. At the end of the novel, Astasha does not reach his father's truth, nor does he unearth Pugachev's gold. The earth will not yield its buried treasure. The very materiality of the environment, the land, the soil itself, frustrates Astasha's quest and makes him reconsider the rightness of his selfish code of honor and revenge. The enchanted natural environment moves Astasha's ethics from a personal belligerent code towards something more humble, something that acknowledges the transcendent power of the enchanted natural environment. Astasha's ethical development in this way certainly seems to owe something to the enchanted nature surrounding him. But as I discussed earlier, Zolota Bunta not only depicts an enchanted setting, the novel itself creates enchantment in its readership. Recalling Bennett's claim that enchantment can move behaviors, how does Ivanov's text affect readers' activities or ethics in the real world? This question lies at the heart of Ivanov's public image, which positions him as a writer of more than bestsellers, as an author instead who corresponds to what Ilya Kukulin calls the traditional mission of the Russian writer. That is, an author who produces not only entertaining but edifying literature, who provides a moral foundation for his time. Marina and Vladimir Abashev articulate one such potential foundation. They have made Ivanov's writing the centerpiece of their geopoetics, in which, quote, "mountains and rivers live, not in the sense of banal metaphors, but in their essence, in which their ancient energy determines the march of history and human fates." Ivanov's novels, they say, are dominated by, quote, "an unusual and intense experience of the landscape." There is something inaccessible, primordial, spellbounding in his descriptions, which has the power to turn landscapes into types of geopoetic images that reveal the Earth's inner power. The Abashev's mission is essentially ecological. Geopoetics, they hope, will encourage ethical engagement with the local environment, starting with tourism. In an article entitled, quote, "The Works of Aleksei Ivanov as a Factor in the Development of Internal Tourism in the Perm Region," They argue that a recent uptick in regional tourism can be attributed in part to readers in the thrall of Ivanov's novels. Part of that tourism can certainly be traced to an annual festival based on Ivanov's earlier historical novel, Sirtse Parmy, The Heart of Parma. The eponymous festival, according to its press release, celebrates the, quote, land, culture, traditions, and includes a 15th century style wedding festival featuring local brides and grooms. Its goal, the director says, is to create, quote, a space in which the traditions of and realities of the past transform into the present and perhaps even into the future, even though these traditions and realities of the past are those imagined by Ivanov and not real ones. They will transition into the real present and into the future. The festival, which continues today under the name Ethno-Landscape Festival, The Call of Parma, Ethno-Landschaftni Festival, which is a strange name, calls all those who, quote, wish to become closer to the traditions of their native region and immerse themselves in the history and culture of the ancient local land. The festival's Contactia page reports attendance above 4,000 for Call of Parma 2014. This is just the program, or the beginning of the program. Ivanov himself encourages these efforts to transform his imagined past into the actual present. He has produced an array of documentary works devoted to the area and designed, apparently, to bring the world of his novels into contemporary reality. One such book, published only in Perm, is a two-volume hiking guide of the region, including trails followed by characters in several novels. Another, Message Chusovaya, acquaints readers, this is from the book jacket, quote, acquaints readers with the locations where all the novels take place, first and foremost with the river Chusovaya, which, Ivanov assures us, is an ideal spot for tourism. These books presume familiarity with Ivanov's fiction, implying that an encounter with the novel might move readers to further engagement, to visit the region, or to read further about its fascinating history and geography. Ivanov's 2013 photo album, Uvidit Ruski Bunt, To See a Russian Rebellion, does something similar. It offers readers an armchair tour around the sites of Pugachev's rebellion, while promising to reveal the unlearned lessons of the 18th century peasant uprising. No one knows what the Pugachev rebellion was. This is a quote. Никто не знает, что такое Пугачевщина, declares the book's first line, suggesting that the answer will be provided in due course. However, ceding his interpretive authority, Ivanov assures us that the land itself contains the key to understanding Pugachev, and his authorial task is only to guide us. The book's huge format, it's huge and heavy, so heavy I didn't want to bring it here. Actually, suggests that it is not intended as a field guide, but a coffee table book. In other words, its pictures are meant to stand in for the absent land, rather than guide readers through the real landscapes. But throughout the book, we get no completely clear view of the geography portrayed. Each picture has been inscribed with Ivanov's text, assigning meaning where it might have otherwise been elusive or ambiguous. Even pictures of monuments bear Ivanov's re-inscriptions, channeling interpretation and framing reception. The rest of the views of the natural landscape are likewise cluttered with words. This very same land, which in the fictional world of Zolota Bunta derives its power by being beyond human comprehension, has here been rendered legible, interpretable. What was the transcendent value of Astasha's world is now one part of a larger argument about how history and territory create what Ivanov calls identity or identichnost. Diverse physical landscapes, he argues, dictate how life is lived and, quote, develop moral norms and systems of value, which in turn become the basis for diverse local identities. To see a Russian rebellion, Ivanov writes, is to understand how these local identities are formed by geography and how they interact with history. The true lesson of Pugachev's rebellion then becomes one about identity politics. Quote, for the 21st century, Pugachev's rebellion means the fight for identity. Read side by side, Zolota Bunta and Uvidit Ruski Bunt can be seen as two constituent parts to a single argument, which is less interesting in its conclusion than in the circuitous path it takes to get there. This very modern argument about identity and local consciousness starts with an enchanting experience of an aestheticized pre-modern setting. This encounter pushes readers to further engagement with the land, now no longer in the imagined past, but in contemporary reality. If Ivanov's documentary works do their job, then his readers encounter a contemporary geography that is updated, but not disenchanted. Instead, the animism of the pre-modern setting has matured into the power of a contemporary regional landscape capable of generating value systems and forging local identities. Thank you.
So next up, we have Mark Lipovetsky. He has received his PhD in 1989 and his Doctor of Philology in 1996 from Ural State University. He is a professor of Russian studies at the University of Colorado Boulder, the author of 8 books, 15 co-edited volumes, and more than 100 articles on various aspects of Russian literature and culture of the 20th and 21st centuries. His paper today is titled The Logic of a Regional Cultural Revolution, Sverdlovsk in the Perestroika Period and Aleksei Ivanov's Yo-Burg.
Thank you very much, Rachel. In my paper, I will focus on a cultural surge, explosion, or even cultural revolution that had happened in Sverdlovsk, Ekaterinburg, since 1991, during Perestroika and early post-Soviet years, and whose echo still keeps defining a cultural status of this city. For the analysis of this phenomenon, I'll use a source book a recent volume, Yo-Burg, by the same author about Bradley just spoke, by Aleksei Ivanov, and why does it look like that? Okay, I'm sorry. And of course, Bradley's paper saves me from the lengthy introduction here. As Bradley mentioned, Ivanov has a cycle, actually, of non-fictional books about the Urals, and these books all aim to conceptualize the Ural specificity as a cultural and historically distinguished region of Russia. Yo-Burg belongs to this cycle, this volume consists of 100 non-fictional stories about prominent cultural, political, and criminal figures acting in Yekaterinburg from the late 80s to 2000s, as well as about more spectacular episodes of the political struggle, mafia wars, and cultural scandals. Although Ivanov lives permanently in Perm, he has spent his university years in Sverdlovsk, Ekaterinburg, and knows it quite well. Yo-Burg, in Ivanov's interpretation, is the name of the city in transition between the Soviet Sverdlovsk and wealthy post-Soviet Ekaterinburg. Yet he suggests that it was Yo-Burg of Perestroika and the early 90s that has emerged as a true capital of the Garnozavodskaya civilization. Although Ivanov treats cultural phenomena along with other aspects of the city's turbulent unofficial history, I would like to argue that the Sverdlovsk cultural revolution has reshaped the regional identity, not as a narrow geographical, but as an all-Russian, rather universally post-Soviet phenomenon, and by this means has solidified the symbolic centrality of Yo-Burg as the capital of the Urals. Sverdlovsk, before the Perestroika, was not a cultural desert, as one might imagine, but its cultural life was not much different from that in other Russian cities of a similar size, about 1 million population, and same administrative status, a center of the large industrial oblast. It had two literary journals, Ural and Uralsky Sledopyt. The latter was the sole Soviet journal specializing in science fiction, large writers, artists, and composers' unions, 5 theaters, as well as the Philharmonic Concert Hall, a respected conservatory, and the Urals Folk Chorus. Sverdlovsk housed a dozen of colleges and universities, among which the largest were Ural Polytechnic Institute, Ural State University, and the School of Mines. Sverdlovsk cultural self-imaging, as any narrative of this kind, was fragmented and included several discourses of different origin, legends about the city's founders, Tatarstan and Degenin, stories about Demidov, mostly Demidov and his ascendants, some stories about Stroganovs, nostalgic narratives of the Urals millionaires, mainly informed by Mamin Sibiryak's novels, hushed memory of the execution of the royal family in 1918, Soviet narratives of Ural Oporny Kray Державы, the Urals as the bearing region of the state, which were supported and at the same time debated by semi-official counter-narrative of various technogenic catastrophes and horrible ecology. However, the central role in the imagined mythology of the Urals and Sverdlovsk played Pavel Petrovich Bajov's tales, skazy, glorifying the craft of local stone carvers. This skazy formed exactly this symbolic core around which all these discourses were grouping. First published in 1939 as a collection of the Urals workers' folklore about the stone carvers and their interactions with class enemies and fantastic spirits at the background of the Urals of the 18th, early 19th century. Bajov tales, in fact, were an individual author's mythology of the region. This was a pure case of fake lore. This mythology in the 40s, 50s had been incorporated into the discourse of Soviet nationalism as the glorification of Mother Russia, gladly sharing its riches with the true men of labor. A closer analysis, however, reveals in Bajov's tales quite an opposite mythology. Motifs of the uncanny dominating in his skazy, in my interpretation, are associated with the repressed memories of the indigenous cultures predating Russia's colonization of the Urals in the 17th century. Instead of the sense of people's kinship with their native land, Bajov highlights their alienation from it. This uncanny groundlessness manifests itself through images of fantastic mountain spirits. Typically fearsome, they sometimes may appear as benevolent donors, yet their unpredictable and capricious character rules out any idea of control over nature as ridiculously irrelevant. This mythology of the Urals indeed has shaped the core of the regional cultural identity. Curiously, Bajov's tales are not universally known across the Urals, but are perceived by people living there as the region's ancient folklore, despite the fact that they were created in the 1930s. Sverdlovsk population in the 20th century absorbed at least three waves of large-scale migrations. The first one happened in the 30s, when the city had become one of the centers of industrialization and construction of such giants of five-year plans as Uralmash or Elmash had been absorbing hundreds of thousands of decolocalized peasants, engineers, technicians, and their families. During the wartime, Sverdlovsk appraised as one of the major hubs for evacuation, and several major plants and universities from the European part of the USSR had moved here. A large number of intelligentsia members from Moscow and Leningrad stayed in Sverdlovsk during the war, leaving behind a host of students and followers. Finally, Sverdlovsk, you've seen this map already, played a significant role in the geography of Gulag, and you can see that Sverdlovsk is surrounded by a very thick layer of various concentration camps. Surrounded by concentration camps and housing, several sharashkas, including the one where the famous tank T-34 was designed. Sverdlovsk was not included in the short list of cities banned for former inmates' residence. And therefore, a large number of victims of the Great Terror, after their release, remained living in Sverdlovsk, along with many professional criminals. The former prisoners of the infamous 58th article of the Soviet Penal Code and their family members are in many ways responsible for the predominantly anti-Stalinist and generally latent anti-Soviet cultural atmosphere in Sverdlovsk of the 60s and 80s, from 60s to the 80s. This multi-layered pie of newcomers likens Sverdlovsk with such large metropolis as Moscow or Leningrad. However, the lack of a prominent cultural tradition contributed to a peculiar sense of alienation from the place about which I started speaking, which suggests a parallel with Creole communities. Several technogenic catastrophes, such as the 1979 fire at the secret lab developing formerly banned biological weapons, and an ensuing epidemics of anthrax, officially coded as cow's foot and mouth disease, Yashur, along with the high level of pollution, enhanced this sense of alienation. Military plants and research institutes had been dominating Sverdlovsk economy since the 1940s. This explains why the city remained closed for most of foreigners, except for visitors from the select communist bloc countries until Perestroika. It also explains a high rate of scientific and technological intelligentsia within its population. Historically, this was a cultural strata that has played a decisive role in the formation of the post-Stalinist liberalism. Hence, a general openness of the city population to the Perestroika triggered political discussions and democratic reforms. It was Sverdlovsk where the first open political debate club was established in 1988 as a model for many other analogous clubs across the USSR. Along with the fact that Yeltsin for more than a decade served as the head of the regional party organization, democratic predilections turned Sverdlovsk into a flagship of the anti-communist movement and the most enthusiastic supporter of Yeltsin during his struggle with Gorbachev, or rather with central Moscow-based authorities. Illuminatingly, during the March 1991 referendum for or against the preservation of the USSR, the Sverdlovsk region was the only subject of Russian Federation where the vote for the preservation of the Union did not reach the mark of 50%, a result similar to Baltic National Republics. During the coup d'etat of August 1991, Sverdlovsk had been prepared to house Yeltsin's government in case of his ousting from Moscow. Yet neither the Creole-like alienation from the area nor the confrontation with Moscow domination taken separately can explain the cultural and intellectual surge in the Perestroika period. Sverdlovsk, one of the participants of this process, the writer Olga Slavnikova ironically writes, «Странный взрыв интеллектуальной и творческой активности, наблюдаемый здесь, in Sverdlovsk-Екатеринбург, в последние полтора десятилетия, инициирован каким-то мутагенным фактором, связанным с нашей это экологией». So it's initiated by some kind of mutation stemming from bad ecology. Several major phenomena have emerged in Sverdlovsk almost simultaneously, and several dozens of very talented writers, artists, musicians, film and theater directors have been living there next to one another. They were involved into a joint circle united by mutual influences, shared interests, ideas, and tastes, as well by the quest for radical cultural innovation and no less radical rejection of Soviet cultural norms and expectations. And of course, in the following, I will very briefly remind of the brightest stars of that process. Naturally, around these bright stars, there were many, many other people, and the overall circle of cultural actors was larger than 400 or 500 people, including spectators, constant spectators. It was even larger. So, of course, the first and most famous phenomenon of the Sverdlovsk cultural revolution was rock music. It was the most visible aspect and was associated with the formation of the Sverdlovsk Rock Club, opened in 1986, the second rock club in the USSR after the Leningrad one. Rock club was organizing annual rock festivals that very promptly had become national sensation, and its permanent participants included, but was not limited by such Sverdlovsk-based but nationally famous groups as Nautilus Pompilius, Chaif, Agatha Christie, Nastya, Aprilsky Marsh, and some others. Many books and articles are written about the Urals rock, yet typically it is discussed outside of its local context, while in fact it was inseparable from it. And for instance, the author of text for Nautilus, Ilya Karmiltsev, was a very prominent literary figure, and it was all interconnected. Contemporary art. Since 1987, Sverdlovsk witnessed a series of free, i.e. uncensored, exhibitions of nonconformist art held at the former building of the Station of Free Postals, Stanza Volnych Pocht. You can see it's inside on the top photograph, and later in another building, and here you can see the actual photograph of the line to the to this exhibition in the not at the central place of the city, as a matter of fact. It's the organizer of this exhibit was an artist, Viktor Makhotin. In Alexei Ivanov's words, Makhotin переформатировал выставку в нечто небывалое. Приходить сюда можно было в любое время дня и ночи. Привечали всех.
Поэты читали здесь стихи, живописцы живописали, лекторы проводили беседы, и все желающие спорили о чем угодно, иной раз чуть не до, не до мордобоя. Probably the most prominent artistic phenomenon and most original artistic phenomenon of Sverdlovsk contemporary art scene were the neo-primitivist art and skomarokh-like performances of Evgeny Malakhin, better known by his pseudonym B.U. Kashkin and Starik Bukashkin. Bukashkin has organized around himself a group of young artists and followers titled Kartinnik, with which he painted city fences and garbage cans and performed primitivist songs of their own composition in Sverdlovsk and other cities. To the popularity of this group testifies the fact that in Kartinnik's performances, along with its permanent actors, participated Mike Nauminka, Yanka Diagileva, Igor Letov, and many others. Bukashkin's disciple, Alexander Shaburov, since 1999 as a part of the art group Blue Noses, has also created a series of exhibitions and performances in Ekaterinburg of 1987-1993, which brought him a reputation of one of the most inventive post-conceptualists. Having moved to Moscow and becoming a prominent figure in the worldwide contemporary art, Shaburov has dedicated his show at the Moscow Biennale in 2009 to Bukashkin, and it was basically a little museum of Bukashkin there. Cinema. A mediocre and provincial Sverdlovsk film studio, previously known by its quasi-epic and horrible films about the Ural's past, in the late 80s had been undergoing the process of reformatting and reinvention. First of all, it has become associated with films of Vladimir Khatinenko, a former graduate of the Sverdlovsk Architectural Institute, who has been working at the studio since 1978. Between 84 and 93, Khatinenko, although living predominantly in Moscow, has produced at Sverdlovsk Film Studio seven of his films, including such prominent ones as Zerkalo de Geroya, 1987 screenplay by another Sverdlovsk native, Nadezhda Kazhushanaya, and Makarov, 1993. Yeah, sure. Not yet famous, Alexei Balabanov, in 1985-89, worked as an assistant of director at the Sverdlovsk Film Studio and made here his first three shorts, Раньше было другое время, 1987, У меня нет друга, One Step Beyond, 1988, with a cameo appearance of main luminaries of the Sverdlovsk Rock Club, including Butusov, and finally, his diploma for the high director's courses, Nastya Yegor, about two stars of the Urals rock scene, Nastya Polyeva and Igor Belkin. However, most importantly, Sverdlovsk Film Studio has become a center of the new documentary cinema and the site of the annual festival of documentaries titled Russia. It has also housed a new school of animation under the leadership of Alexander Petrov in 2000. He will win the Oscar for his animated film, The Old Man and the Sea. His disciples will produce famous animated films such as Gagarin by Alexei Kharitidi and Девочка Дура by Зоя Киреева. Theater. Two theaters, the Theater of the Young Spectators and the Opera House, have become the centers of innovation and targets of heated debates in the late 80s, early 90s. Choose under the intellectual leadership of its head of the literary department, Oleg Laevsky, brought in two young and daring directors, Dmitry Astrakhan, who lived in Ekaterinburg in 1981-87, and Anatoly Proudin lived in 89-96. Astrakhan, who later will become one of the most visible Russian film and TV directors, has earned his first fame in Sverdlovsk by the stage versions of Van Visin's Niedrasel and Ostrovsky's Dohodnoe Mesto. These performances were attacked by the nationalist organization Otechestvo, the Urals branch of the infamous Pamyat, for a blasphemous, or rather blasphemously hilarious, interpretations of Russian classical dramas. So the Tangeza story is an old one indeed. Proudin shined in his surrealist productions of Иуда Искариот by Леонид Андреев, Горе от ума, Alice Behind the Looking Glass by Lewis Carroll, Человек рассеянный by Семен Маршак, all based on Natalia Skarakhod's inventive stage versions. For Alice, Proudin actually was awarded one of the last Soviet state prizes, Госпремия of 1991. Another theatrical revolution has been happening at the stage of the Sverdlovsk Opera House, where the director Alexander Titель, later the head of the Moscow Stanislavsky Musical Theater, and conductor Evgeny Kolobov, he will create the new opera in Moscow, stunned conservatives by such fresh and innovative productions as the Hoffman's Tales and new opera The Prophet about Pushkin by Vladimir Kabekin, and especially Rimsky-Korsakov's The Tale of Tsar Saltan, which has also enraged nationalists from Otechestvo who have detected in this cheerful performance the propaganda of Zionism. Literature, very briefly. Writers, poets, and critics were actively involved in theatrical and art endeavors, but specifically literary innovations were associated with the so-called experimental issue of the journal Ural, 1988 number one, which became a bestseller and was sold at black markets, apparently, and later a journal within a journal titled Text, which has been appearing four times a year as a part of Ural in 1991. And I wouldn't bother you with a long list of authors participating in these projects. If one tries to detect a unifying style of this new artistic and cultural phenomena, she or he would face a striking combination of contrasting polarities: hyperrealism and postmodernism, brutality and sentimentality, playful sophistication and naive art. Actually, the only common feature could be detected in the exclusion of the middle, i.e. the stylistic middle ground, exemplified either by psychological realism or reader-viewer-oriented poetics of kitsch and blockbuster. Apparently, activists of the Sverdlovsk Cultural Revolution did not attempt to lead the masses towards perestroika and democratization. Rather, they sought radical experiments that would manifest profound intellectual and emotional liberation from the stale Soviet normalcy. Their goal was an enthusiastic quest for new cultural languages. These new languages of a free culture, frequently imagined by them as politically non-engaged, were to be invented from the material of universally recognized, or on the contrary, avant-gardist and modernist discourses, but not according to regional or national traditions. Traditions were rejected by them as deeply compromised by their intertwining with Soviet discourses, and all things Soviet were negated most radically. This is why, while seemingly belonging to the regional culture, this new phenomenon radically problematized the very concept of the regional culture. None of Sverdlov's cultural actors in the late 80s, early 90s did exploit or attempt to invent anything resembling color locale. All the works produced during this period did not present themselves as phenomena belonging to the Urals culture. Rather, they strived to develop new forms for Russia, or even more ambitiously global culture, as they imagined it, of course, which suggested indifference to any regional traditions or idiosyncratic features. Regionalism, exemplified by Aleksei Ivanov, belongs to the 2000-2010s. It will arise a decade after as a reaction to the cultural innovation of the perestroika period. The philosopher Artemy Magun has defined the dominant spirit of perestroika through the comparison with the Great French Revolution by a concept of the negative revolution. According to Magun, quote, before the face of the revolution, a contemporary subject has to turn to himself. Revolution negation, seeking an absolute separation from the past, turns the society against itself as its own past, end quote. One may argue that in Sverdlov's cultural innovation, perestroika's negative revolution found its adequate manifestation, probably most adequate. It was the Ural's rootlessness that has best of all resonated with the logic of internalized negation. It was a peculiar regional cultural identity that allowed to incorporate into the negated past the concepts of regional tradition and regional culture. However, due to the fact that the knowledge and understanding of the global culture among Sverdlov's cultural activists was inevitably fragmented and eclectic, their overall cultural production represented a very specific, if idiosyncratic, or even regional version of global tendencies such as postmodernism, hyperrealism, or neo-avant-garde. In other words, the quest for non-regional, non-national forms and cultural languages appeared in Sverdlov's perestroika culture as the paradoxical expression of the regional or other centrifugal cultural specificity. While negating Moscow-centered culture and politics, Sverdlov's cultural revolutionaries offered their own scripts for new Russian or other new post-Soviet culture, universal, non-regional, and regional at the same time. Through the prism of Alexander Atkin's concept of internal colonization, this cultural movement can be interpreted as a post-colonial one, wherein the regional colony appropriates the center's function to formulate cultural norms for the entire, albeit collapsing, empire. And I will stop here because the time is up. Thank you very much.
Jane Koslow, Bates College. Wow, fantastic panel. I'm really awake, and it's not because of the coffee. I'd love to hear more about this idea of geopoetics and the folks who are just kind of what they're up to and who they are and where they are. And then a quick question for Mark. What about financing? So this extraordinary explosion or evolution and where's the financing come from? And I also just wonder, this is going to sound kind of silly maybe, but at some point there are direct air flights from Yekaterinburg to Europe, right? And so what role is that way after the fact, and that's just a confirmation of a kind of embeddedness in global transportation that facilitates circulation of artists and thinkers and ideas, or does that actually play some kind of dynamic role in the way things develop? Just, accessibility.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, thank you for the question. Microphone. All right. So, geopoetics, this term is developed in English language academic discourse as well as Russian. I'm trying to look up right now what the English language book sources are. I haven't gotten too deep into it, but there is a Center for Geopoetics out of Scotland that it's at geopoetics.org, so you can find that pretty easily. The two who I cited are Vladimir Abashev and Marina Abasheva. They are a husband and wife pair working out of Perm State University, and they are trying to sort of import this terminology into the Russian discourse. They're philologists by training, but they're trying to sort of expand into a more interdisciplinary sort of cultural studies thing, which is very alive in Perm State University and mostly published through the Viesnik Permskaya Universiteta. So that's where I found most of their stuff. You can look deeper into it, but Ivanov becomes this sort of central figure of this move towards developing a poetics that both takes from aesthetic experiences but then drives ecological ethics.
Thank you for the question. If Bradley would permit me, I might add about geopoetics that Vladimir Abashev also authors the book about Permsky text, and actually this book was republished several times. Permkak text, yes. Permkak text. Thank you. Thank you so much. A very, very, very precise question about financing. And actually, this is a very important aspect, and in a way, it explains the situation because it's not my thought that Anatoly Proudin, one of these theater directors I mentioned, used to say it was the blessed time. The censorship has left, but the state financing for culture remained. It was this very, very short window between the end of the ideological oppression but beginning of capitalist repression, right? And notably, this explosion ends after 1993 when the majority of the stars move either to Moscow or to Petersburg or elsewhere. But what is interesting there is that they didn't leave behind the burned area. Sverdlovsk remains very, very culturally active city, and actually, I had it in my paper, so I'm using the chance. Unlike Perm, it demonstrates an opposite model of cultural development. As you know, Perm was a bursting of talents, festivals, events, when there was this landing party from Moscow led by Marat Gilman. But when this thing ended and the regional administration stopped supporting this process, things started to fade away. Sverdlovsk is, Yekaterinburg, is much more self-sufficient. It has lots of its own sources. It's not isolated. It constantly invites people from outside, but it has coming new sources. It had become the site for the Urals School of New Drama. Kalida Theater is nationally famous. Aleksei Fedorchenko, one of the leading film directors, continues living and shooting in Yekaterinburg, etc. There are more phenomena. As to the airport and openings, until recently, the director of Yekaterinburg Opera was an Italian conductor who was working there. And yes, indeed, Yekaterinburg, there were big investments into the air flight, and the new airport was built, and there are direct flights connecting with Berlin, with Prague, with London, charter flights to Israel and to all these resort areas. However, the most difficult connection for Yekaterinburg is with Siberia. So in order to fly from Yekaterinburg to Novosibirsk, the person has to fly first to Moscow and then to Novosibirsk. So it's much easier to fly to Europe than to the eastern part of Russia.
Hi, Tyler Kirk, Arizona State University. And this is a question for you, Dr. Lipovetsky. So you pointed out the high concentration of gulag camps, labor colonies, special settlements, Sverdlovsk. And you mentioned that a lot of people remained there after they were released from the camps, whether they were forced to or chose to, and that it was a closed city. So, but what was the, how did they contribute to this sort of cultural revolution and sort of the transition to Yekaterinburg?
Obviously, this was a previous generation, right? So these were basically parents, teachers, mentors of many of these cultural activists. And basically, this sort of layer and the sixth generation of scientific intelligentsia, they created somewhat peculiar atmosphere in Sverdlovsk, Yekaterinburg. Very much liberal, as I said. It was this paradox that is described in relation to the scientific intelligentsia, when due to the fact that they were working for military projects, certain liberty of thought and conversation was allowed. And since almost all people involved with technology in Yekaterinburg were working for the war, that was a natural atmosphere there. But it was all intertwined. The people married, people had relatives, so it was really hard to find anyone in that didn't have any connection from the Gulag. It was very, very peculiar. Not necessary. People were returning from camps, and indeed, frequently Yekaterinburg or Sverdlovsk at that moment was much easier to find a place to live and find job, which was very important, than going back to Moscow or elsewhere. There were always jobs for qualified people in the 60s and 70s, more or less open, much more open.
I had a question for Mark. It was a follow-up to the Gulag question, which is, does the Gulag appear in any of the works or the theater or anything, any aspect of the culture and the art? I've been reading a lot about how Russian filmmakers are really reticent to depict the Gulag. So I was curious about that. And then could you say a little bit more about the literature from the area?
There was not much of Gulag representation. Surprisingly, it was pretty indirect. So there was this shadow of Gulag in Khatinyanka's Zerkalo для героя. There was this sort of overarching presence of Gulag somewhere nearby. There is scenes associated with Gulag in Alexander Ivanchenko's novel Monogramma. But other than that, I really cannot recall anything directly pointing out that. And if it would be there, it would have been discussed, though. So this testifies to what I was trying to say. They were trying to create very much universalized kind of language. They were not reacting to historical reality of the region. So they were trying to build some kind of the cosmic bridge, but building it by the bricolage methods, picking up whatever they knew, mixing up, I don't know, Solzhenitsyn, not much of Solzhenitsyn actually, Teilhard de Chardin with Derrida, for instance. These were fantastic mixtures. But Ivanov is as I said, Ivanov's return to the Urals is the reaction to this universalism of the perestroika period. Georg was written in 1995, and his big construction of the Ural civilization, as he calls it, is the project of the 2000s, 2010s. So it is the next wave. In the works of the authors from the 2000s, you can find much more references to the Gulag, but not in that period of perestroika that I'm talking about, which makes it very different, because everybody was writing about Gulag, everybody was writing about Stalin, but not there. And as to literature, I can tell later. There is more to this, I'm sorry.
I have a question for John. And that is about in the sources that you analyzed for us, but also in the other things that you've looked at, sort of historical, you know, interpretations of historical past in Tatar and Russian culture. Is anything said about the peoples of the Volga region other than the Tatars and the Russians, you know, the smaller peoples who in the 19th century seemed to be, I mean, a lot of Russians and Tatars felt that since they had been from animist cultures, that they were kind of destined to convert either to Christianity if they hadn't already, or to Islam, and Russians and Tatars are sort of competing over them. Do they play any role in this, the Tatar memory?
Thanks. I haven't seen a lot about the other peoples. There is actually, so there's a, I don't think he's a historian, but he writes kind of popular history, I think. His name is Vahit Imamov, and he's been writing, he actually writes a lot of historical novels that are all in Tatar, so like I've glanced at them, but I haven't been able to read too much of them. But he also has a kind of pamphlet that was published in 94, I think, and it was just like, you know, a 10,000 or maybe even like 1,000 tiraj, and it's actually about the Pugachev rebellion and how that plays into the kind of various peoples. That talks about Tatars and Bashkirs and others. I haven't seen a lot about the kind of like smaller peoples of the Volga. It's mostly about Tatars and Krashans, and then I would say that there's some about Bashkirs. But I mean, as far as what I've been looking at, it's kind of limited to, you know, mostly Tatar things.
Okay. Quick second question. Is it your sense that it's really just Tatars reading this stuff? You said that the film was subtitled into Russian. Do you sense that a lot of Russians are paying attention to this literature, or is it really just Tatars?
I honestly can't imagine that many Russians are picking up on it or would really be interested in it. I mean, even just living in Tatarstan, the amount of interest that Russians seem to have in Tatar culture or Tatar history is almost none. I was there for 2 months studying Tatar, and at the end of the 2 months, my like peer tutor's wife was a Tatar teacher in, I think, like a high school, and she said in 2 months I had learned more Tatar and more about Tatars than any of her Russian students had, who were like, you know, in their teens. So, I mean, I think there's very little interest. I know that in some writings, Feuze Beydemova is a pretty prominent nationalist figure who, Dr. Kefeli, Beydemova?
Yeah.
Dr. Kefeli has written a lot about who, when she does interviews in Russian, she doesn't say the kind of inflammatory things that she says, like in her Tatar writing. When in the stuff that I was looking at, I didn't see too much of that. I mean, from what I could tell, the translation from Tatar to Russian was, you know, pretty much the same. But I know that there's certainly things that Tatars say in Tatar that Russians obviously can't hear. But I think even when Russians are, or when Tatars are talking about their own history, even in Russian, I imagine that there's not a lot of attention paid by Russians.
So it's pretty much the same as when I was spending a lot of time there.
Yeah.
Okay, just a very quick follow-up comment to the question that Mark got about the Gulag. I just wanted to point out that in Sverdlovsk, Ekaterinburg, documentary filmmakers in the Perestroika period did address the Gulag. The very first film about repatriates from China was made by Boris Uretsky in 1993, Chuzhiye Goroda, and it didn't just focus on the Gulag, but it did talk about those Harbinsi who had been repressed.
Yeah, you're right. You're absolutely right.
I'm completely lost, sorry. No, I just have a question to John, and two questions, actually. First, if you think if it is productive to use some post-colonial theories, post-colonial approach to research like similar to what you are doing. And the second one is more discussing this identity negotiation, because you were several times kind of mentioning that from the beginning you were saying that still Tatarstan is trying to present its image like different from Chechnya and so on. So you were coming to precedence. But I mean, how do you see it? How this renegotiation of these two sides of identity is coming? Because Tatarstan is usually painted in the Russian Federation as the region of tolerance and, you know, all these ideas. So at the same time, we see in the cultural spheres all this happening. So is it divided by spheres, by people, or is it the same people? What did you observe, really? I mean, is it a kind of political sphere totally separated from the cultural sphere, which is impossible? I'm just curious because I myself am trying to understand this question. Thank you.
Thanks. So as far as like thinking about this in terms of like post-colonial theory or stuff like that, I certainly see Tatarstan and, I mean, the Russian Empire, the Russian Federation, the Soviet Union as imperial projects. I think that's a very apt way to think about it. I think that the way that the regions, especially the ethnic regions, although, you know, everyone else is talking about Russian regions, so I suppose they have an argument to be made too, that a lot of these ethnic regions have a complicated imperial history with Russia in terms of how they were incorporated, the kind of rights they had, and even still today, the fact that Tatarstan was brought into the Russian Federation in 94 kind of under this, you know, bilateral agreement that wasn't, you know, they're not just another state, they kind of have this different status, and even now today they still maintain that. I mean, as far as, you know, post-colonial theory like Chakravarti or stuff like that, I mean, I'm not like, I don't use that kind of stuff, but I certainly think the kind of the idea of looking at this as an imperial situation, as, you know, how have Tatars been Russified through this project? How was the Soviet Union, by kind of putting the Soviet kind of Europeanized culture over these peoples? You know, Tatars have to have their own opera. They have to have the kind of European models of culture that was, you know, that was exported to not only places like Tatarstan, but Central Asia with the ballet, with the opera, things like that. So as far as looking at this in imperial kind of way, I think that's a very effective way to look at it. I wouldn't argue necessarily that's the only way, but it's certainly the way that I think about it. As far as the kind of these different identities or the idea of Tatarstan as this region of tolerance, as I was, you know, I tried to get at, I don't think that increased nationalism, either Russian nationalism or Tatar nationalism, necessarily means there will be conflict. I think in some ways, as both nationalisms grow, it might still, because of Eurasianism, because of the way in which the nationalisms are kind of like separatist as opposed to kind of arguing over the same peoples, they don't necessarily come into conflict in that many places other than people like Kroshans, or I imagine other Volga peoples who kind of don't fit these models of, you know, if you're Russian, you should be Orthodox. If you're a Turkic person, you should be Muslim. So I think for those peoples who are kind of on the cusp of this, I think that it is problematic. Because Tatarstan has now, with kind of the defeat of political sovereignty, has moved more towards bringing back Islam into the public sphere, there is, to some extent, the kind of the threat from, you know, more radicalist Islamic type of thinking. There was a suicide bombing, or I don't know if it's a suicide bombing, but there was a bombing in Tatarstan just a couple summers ago, in which a kind of a pretty liberal or reformist Muslim cleric was killed, was targeted. So there is this potential for violence there. From what I've seen in actual interaction between people, I didn't see that. Tatars and Russians, you know, seem to get along fine, although they don't, you know, Russians don't care about Tatar culture and that kind of stuff, but they're not fighting in the streets or anything like that. But I think that part of this new nationalism, the kind of the more radical type of Islam that it may bring, it doesn't necessarily, I don't think it does necessarily, but I think there are the possibilities for that, and certainly, I mean, more radical orthodoxy among Russians would also potentially destabilize it. So, I mean, I don't think that Tatarstan is on the verge of some sort of ethnic war or anything, but I think that, like a lot of Russia's ethnic regions that are divided between these peoples, there is potential for conflict. In Tatarstan, Tatars only have a slight majority of the population. I think they're at like maybe 49 or 48%, and Russians are like 45, 44. And the Kroshans are kind of, they're counted as Tatars, but if they were to be counted as their own people, it's very possible that Tatars would no longer be a clear majority of the population. And this is what Tatars really fear, that as soon as they're no longer the majority, it won't be like its own republic anymore. So that there is these fears, we have to make these people Tatar. So I think that Kroshans are kind of the real problem here for Tatars, and likely for Russians too. But as far as, you know, the ethnic violence, I mean, I think that's a distinct possibility, but it's a distinct possibility, I think, in a lot of places in Russia. I don't think it's necessarily more possible in Tatarstan than other places. Thanks.
Hi, I'm Ann Lounsbury, and I have a question for mostly for Brad and Mark, and it's about pedagogy. I'm wondering if schools in the region do anything to inculcate a sense of local identity. Like when I was growing up in California, I got a big, healthy dose of California writers. Have the schools, either in the Soviet period or now, ever tried to cultivate a sense of local identity? Thanks.
I can tell mostly from the post-Soviet experience, because I was somewhat involved into these projects. At a certain point, the colleagues will correct me, in the mid-90s, the regulations coming from federal center and very much supported by the local administrations required to include the so-called regional component into the school courses on literature, which gave the job to my good friends and colleagues, because we all started writing textbooks of the literature of Urals, and they were published. And however, I don't know how stable it is, because as you know, the school curriculum is changing in Russia nowadays faster than the weather in Colorado. So it's really hard to follow that. But in the Urals, from again my experience, that there was also always certain at least signs of respect to local writers. And you see, the school allowed to include, there was some flexibility, and there was always some texts recommended from local writers, and not that these writers were very exciting, but we were reading them. That's what I can say. But in post-Soviet period, it was more or less systematic. Yeah.
I wish I knew more about the school curriculum in the region. I will be going to Ferrum this summer, and that's one of the things I'd like to check out. But the one thing I can add is that Aleksei Ivanov was just recently involved in a student production of one of his staging of one of his books, which is not a one of the books that I talked about, but he is sort of directly involved in these projects that sort of young people bring to life these books. So he's part of this festival that I mentioned, and he's also part of this this play. Information on that can be found on his website, but this is, you know, outside of the school curriculum. I wish I could speak more directly to that.
Okay. Thank you for a fabulous panel. It was very interesting. It's Edith Clues from UVA. I was actually wondering, though, that in these regional art projects, I was seeing, with some exceptions, a pretty pervasive pattern, both among the artistic actors and agents and the characters you talk about in the books that you talk about, that men, I mean, so this is going to be a gender question. Men are the actors, men are the subjects, the thinking people. What was her name? Zuleika is kind of a symbol, maybe more than anything else, it is from what you said, and kind of passive receptors. So my question is, where are, in these local cultures, where are the women who are agents, who are actors and thinking subjects?
Well, as far as Zuleika, I mean, I would say that she's definitely a representative of the Tatar community. She is a symbol. Some of the things that I didn't get to talk about too much are, she eventually is, you know, accused of apostasy, and she's sent to first a monastery to kind of be retrained as an Orthodox Christian, and then eventually is married off to a Russian man named Peter, and then is, you know, forced to bear him a child. And so, I mean, she's passive in the sense that she's kind of like, she has to accept the situation, but when she has the child, and I don't remember the child's Russian name, but she calls him, yeah, it's a male child, and she calls him Zahar, which is his, or no, that must be his Russian name. Anyway, I forget his Tatar name, I guess. But she calls him by his Tatar name exclusively, and she speaks to him only in Tatar. And this leads to this big conflict between the two because, you know, Peter, the Russian, is afraid that she's taking his child away from him, that she's taking him away from Russia and from Orthodoxy and kind of bringing him back to this Muslim Tatarness. And she's, meanwhile, afraid that he's going to take the child to be a Russian, to be an Orthodox. So I would say that she's very active in trying to preserve her identity through her heritage, through her children, through her family. She is very active in that sense. She's constantly praying with him in Tatar. She's constantly, you know, referring to him in Tatar. At the very end of, or I think it's actually towards the beginning, it's a flashback, or it's a flash forward, that she, you know, is on her deathbed and she calls him and she only speaks to him, and he's like dressed in his priest garb because he's becoming a priest, and she's only speaking to him in Tatar and says, "You have to bury me in a Tatar cemetery. You have to honor me because I was never Christian, even though I was baptized." So I think that, you know, although she is to some extent a recipient of kind of this aggression, this, you know, this situation from the missionaries, from the Orthodox missionary project, she is nevertheless acting to preserve her culture through her children, in some sense, through her child. And although we don't know how effective it is, we don't know if he buried her in the Muslim cemetery. We don't know. But he kind of, you can see it in his eyes that he sees this connection. So I think, you know, I think women still have this role to play, at least kind of ideally in how these Tatars are thinking about it as kind of the preservers and bearers of this culture. But yeah, I suppose, you know, the main characters aren't, you know, in the story, there are no women. So interesting, yeah, interesting to think about.
I'm afraid I don't have a lot of great news for you either. But So this book plays out in its adventure plot in a lot of ways as a male fantasy. There's a lot of things with that. There are, as in a lot of sort of post-colonial male fantasies, there's a doubling of sex partners, one as a local bagula, and then which is the Mansi, the folk term for the Mansi, and then the other one as a Russian, ethnic Russian, named Nizhdana, who, spoiler alert, bears him a child at the end of the book. exactly. It is, of course, a male child. Yeah. No, why would they? But the moments of you know, glimmers of some sort of feminine sort of active agency in this book come from two places. The one is the native Boite, which is the native woman who he encounters for a while. She is magical. And through the sexual encounters that they have, she directs his sort of spiritual existence in a way that that is not available to Russians and is otherwise not available to Astasha himself. So she has a little bit of agency there, although she uses that agency to basically do whatever he wants, basically to make him into the best river captain possible. The other female agency in the book is the river Chusovaya, which is treated, right, exactly, which is treated often as a personified character. Nizhdana, the Russian woman in the book, says at one point that tries to make the Chusovaya into sort of the third node in a love triangle and says, "You'll never love anybody but the Chusovaya." So there is this sort of sense of that, but it's like I said, not great news. Yeah.
Same here. I was attempting to say. To speak about the fragmentedness, so we all were very much into postmodernism at that moment, but feminism was not on the radar and was completely we heard the word, right, but the perception was completely askew. Curiously, Slavnikova, who is indeed the most bright women writer coming from that explosion, she constantly says, "Oh no, I'm not a feminist. I'm just a good writer who happened to be a woman." That's this very much internalized gender repression that is quite typical for many working with gender issues in Russia. In this Russian cultural text, of course, there is this, on the one hand, two examples. In Bajov's tales, of course, there is this, the main magic figure is called Хозяйка. Хозяйка Медной горы, the mistress of the Copper Mountain, and that's not a patriarchal character. She is basically hearkening back to some matriarchal great goddesses standing on the border of that death world and life, and etc. So this mythology is quite prevalent there. On the other hand, looking back at this cultural milieu, I need to say that, for instance, the main literary authority at that moment around whom the entire circle of exclusively male poets was formed was a poet, Maya Nikulina. She was the mentor of the entire generation of poets, and it was not a salon, it was just her circle, quite literally. Curiously enough, again, in the next generation, in the people who are now in the 30s and culturally active in Ekaterinburg now, I wouldn't say feminist, but gender-oriented writing, sort of consciously gender-oriented writing, is quite prevalent, and there are at least two important names here, poet and prose writer Masha Botyeva and a playwright Yaroslava Pulinovich, who is one of the most popular playwrights now. Her play Natasha na Mechta was produced in 30 theaters only in Russia and elsewhere. And even in Yale it was produced.
Okay, thank you. I just wanted to leave aside the sort of term that is often in Russian culture very negative feminism, and just focus on female agency, right, without any sort of judgmental titles of any sort. But thinking about Slavnikova, her in 2017, the protagonist, of course, is male, but there are two interesting women characters, and the wife is her name's Tamara, the protagonist is actually a very interesting character who's a very successful businesswoman. Just FYI, yeah. Okay,
and she's projected on the Hazyaika myth, which
yes,
is present there.
Yes,
as well.
Yeah, quite true. Okay, thank you.